I would like just to say a few words about the environment and what is the position and the attitude and the theological consideration of the Eastern Orthodox Church and especially the Church of Jerusalem. Rabbi Neril, distinguished fellow panelists, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for this opportunity to make a few remarks to this conference and to participate in this panel. The subject of climate and energy is a vast and crucial one for our time, our region, and our world. All thoughtful people are concerned about the integrity of the environment and the careful human stewardship of our natural resources. The Earth is the common home of all humanity, and we have a moral responsibility to ensure that all humanity is able to share our earthly home. As the prophet and King David says in the Psalms, the earth is the Lord's and all that is in it. There is in the Christian tradition a profound understanding of the goodness of creation and the central place of creation in the sacred history of salvation. Not only do we read in the book of Genesis that God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. Christians also affirm that God, the eternal Logos, took on our flesh in Jesus Christ precisely to make holy this creaturely life and to show us that as those made in the image and likeness of God, we may attain to union with God himself. This pilgrimage to union with God, this theosis or deification, begins in this life set in the midst of creation of which we human beings are a part. In the Christian understanding, on the one hand, creation groans with the birth of pangs of the world to come. What is to be the fulfillment of all things in the original purpose is not yet. As St. Paul says in the letter to the Romans, we know that the whole creation has been groaning in travail together until now. This is borne out in our human experience, for we read in the first letter of John, beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. And yet, on the other hand, creation is also jubilant. We read in the song of the three young men in the book of Daniel, a great hymn of creation, and how the creation itself, the cosmic order, the earth and its creatures, as well as human beings, glorifies the Creator. Bless the Lord, all you works of the Lord. Sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever. Bless the Lord, all your winds. Sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever. Let the earth bless the Lord. Let it sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever. Bless the Lord, all that grows in the ground, seas and rivers, springs and animals. This is an understanding of creation that is not a means to an end, but part of the essential life that God brought into being out of nothing. In the holy tradition of the Church, too, we see a reverence for creation and a celebration of the intimate relationship between creation and the Creator. For example, from the Church Fathers, we read this passage from St. Basil's Reflections on the book of Genesis, the book of known as Hexaemeron. Inverted commas. In the beginning, God created. What a glorious order he first establishes a beginning, so that it might not be supposed that the world never had a beginning. Then he adds, inverted comma, created, to show that which was made was a very small part of the power of the Creator. In the same way that the potter, after having made with equal pains a great number of vessels, has not exhausted either his art or his talent. Thus, the maker of the universe, whose creative power, far from being bounded by one world, could extend to the infinite, needed only the impulse of his will to bring the immensities of the visible world into being. If then the world has a beginning, and if it has been created, inquire who gave it this beginning and who was the creator. For the church fathers, there was a clear understanding of the wonder of creation as well as of reverence for the creator of all. And in the service for the great blessing of the waters of the feast of Theophany or Epiphany, the baptism of the Lord in the River Jordan, we read these words written by our great predecessor, Patriarch Sophronios of Jerusalem. By the way, from the Christian point of view, the Patriarch Sophronios was the successor of Patriarch Abraham, and we continue like this until today. Today, the grace of the Holy Spirit, in the form of a dove, dwelt upon the waters. Today, the sun that never sets has dawned, and the world is made radiant with the light of the Lord. Today, the moon, with its radiant beams, sheds light on the world. Today, the stars, form of light, make the inhabited world lovely with the brightness of their splendor. Today, the clouds rain down from heaven, the shower of justice for humankind. Today, the uncreated by his own will accept the laying on of hands by his own creature. Today, the prophet and forerunner draws near, but stands by with fear, seeing God's condescension towards us. Today, the streams of Jordan, that is river, are changed into healing by the presence of the Lord. Today, all creation is watered by mystical streams. Today, the failings of humankind are being washed away by the waters of Jordan. Today, paradise is open for mortals, and the Sun of Justice shines down to us. Today, the bitter water, as once for Moses' people, is changed to sweetness by the presence of the Lord. The entire liturgical tradition of the Church rings with the imagery of creation and uses such imagery to underscore the message of salvation. However, what is also crystal clear in the Christian tradition is the distinction between the Creator and the creation. The opening chapters of the book of Genesis underscore this point, as does the great so-called prologue of the Gospel of St. John, where he writes, "In the beginning was the Word, that is the Logos, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being." We read also in the Psalms the important verses, in Psalms 101, "Long ago, God, you laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you will endure. They will all wear out like a garment. You change them like clothing, and they pass away. But you are the same, and your years have no end." Respect for creation and effective sustainability depend on the necessary differentiation that we must make between Creator and the creation. They are not the same. and in our concern to ensure the stewardship of the creation and the proper and just use of our natural resources, we function in a kind of priesthood. Priests live on the border. This does not mean that we must be distant. On the contrary, this implies a deep and divine intimacy, and we respond to this intimacy as to a commandment. The care of the environment begins with our own purification and stillness. How many deserts have been turned into both spiritual and physical oases, where, in the restored relationship between human beings and creation, we see the harmony that we are seeking. In this respect, our proper treatment of the environment, which means harmony with creation, is also a reflection of our equally necessary commitment to harmony of the human community and to harmony with our own selves. Thank you very much.